Welcome back to the lesson about trusses and bars. In this video, we will be talking about trusses. In the previous video, we were able to demonstrate how to derive the finite element model for a bar using symbolic manipulator. Here we are going to one step backwards to talk about simple structures that are formed of bars. These structures are called trusses. A truss is one like the one that you see here. The one you see in this picture is a two-dimensional truss that's composed of bars connected at nodes. These bars these trusses can only have loads applied at the nodes. No forces would be applied in the middle of the structure. If any forces are applied in the middle of the structure, then the structure would be called a frame, and we will handle it later. For now, let's start talking about trusses. Trusses have two fundamental problems that differentiate them from simple bars. The first is that we need a rotation of axes, since the bars are not really aligned all in the x-axis. Then there is a logistic problem in the programming of the finite element model of trusses. In this video, we will be talking about the rotation of axes. Now imagine that there is a bar. This bar is just a simple bar like the ones we talked about earlier. It has its element x-axis and its element y-axis. We know very well that the bar only deforms in the x direction of its local x-axis. However, if this axis is not aligned with the global axis of the structure, then we have a rotation angle, and this deformation, let's talk about, for example, U2, when the point 2 moves a distance U2, it actually moves in the global x direction and the global y direction simultaneously. However, we know already that there is no vertical or lateral motion v2 in the local axes. That's why we need to present the equation of motion of the bar in a little bit different way, then see how to apply the rotation of axes. First, let's write down the motions u1, v1, u2, v2 of the bar in terms of the local axes. In the left-hand side, we have the deformations in the global axes, the global x and y, while on the right-hand side here, these are the deformations in the local axes. Notice that always we have VE1 and VE2 equal to 0. To do also a deformation of the force, a transformation of the forces, we will apply the same idea, but in this case we may have we use the same transformation matrix from the local axes to the global axes. Using this into the original equation, the element equation that relates the deformations in the local axes to the forces applied in the local axes. Now let's expand this by introducing V1 and V2. Already V1 and V2 are zeros, and we don't have forces Qy1 or Qy2 in the local axis. However, now we have four equations. Two of them are redundant. They don't say anything extra, but it's written now in terms of 4 degrees of freedom in the local axis. We will use this equation now by replacing the local coordinates. See, here we have U1, UE1, VE1, UE2, VE2. And remember here that we already transformed these displacements from the local axis to the global axis. So if we use this transformation, we will replace the local displacements with the global displacements together with by multiplying them by this transformation method. Similarly, we'll do the same for the global forces. We remove the vector of the local forces and replace it by the vector for the global forces using the transformation matrix. The transformation matrix has a very nice property. It's called an orthogonal matrix. And this matrix, if you try to find the inverse will just be the transpose of the matrix. So we don't really have to create any inversion of the matrix, a 4x4 matrix. We will just transpose it. If you multiply both sides of the equation from the left with the inverse or the transpose of the transformation matrix, this one here will disappear or be replaced by identity matrix, which is which can just be removed. And the other side, you will have the transpose of the transformation matrix multiplied from the left here and the transformation matrix multiplied from the right on here, which can be used to replace the original stiffness matrix, this one, that's a local stiffness matrix, by one that is global. Here is the form we see, the transpose multiplied by the original stiffness matrix multiplied by the rotation matrix again. I don't care actually about seeing how it looks when we do the three matrix multiplication. It's a very simple, straightforward thing, but always the computer will be doing it. I don't care about writing down explicitly how it looks. You can do this by hand or using a symbolic manipulator, but for my interest, this is not really something that I'd like to write explicitly. So finally, this will be the global stiffness matrix, as we said before. In the next video, we will handle the other problem regarding the logistic problem of the truss structure. To summarize quickly, in this video, we obtained a global stiffness matrix in terms of the local stiffness matrix. To obtain this local stiffness matrix, we expanded it by adding two redundant equations and then by multiplying from the left and the right by the inverse transformation matrix and the transformation matrix respectively, we obtained the global stiffness matrix. See you next video.